हेडलाइंस इज स्पॉन्सर्ड बाय वंडर सीमेंट, एक परफेक्ट शुरुआत।
बजट सेशन ऑफ पार्लियामेंट बिगिंस विद द प्रेसिडेंट्स एड्रेस टू द जॉइंट सेशन। In his address, President says violence in the name of protest weakens the nation. PM says this session will be focused mainly on economic issue. Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman presents Economic Survey 2019-20. Survey projects GDP growth of 6 to 6.5% for financial year 2021. GDP growth for current financial year estimated to be 5%. Special Air India flight takes off today from Delhi to evacuate Indians from coronavirus hit Wuhan city of China. Center continuously monitoring the situation in close coordination with state governments. In Jammu and Kashmir, three terrorists killed in a gunfight with security forces this morning. Police team was attacked at Ban Toll Plaza on outskirts of Jammu. Campaigning for Delhi Assembly polls heats up. BJP releases Sankalp Patra for Delhi polls. AAP Chief Arvind Kejriwal holds roadshows. Election Commission to review poll preparations in a special meeting today. In sports, fourth T20I between India and New Zealand goes into super over again. Match tied as India restricts New Zealand to its own score of 165.
Headlines was sponsored by Wonder Cement, एक perfect शुरुआत।
नमस्कार, मैं अभिषेक महाजन। आर टॉप स्टोरी टुडे, फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर निर्मला सीतारमन टेबल द इकोनॉमिक सर्वे 2019-20 इन बोथ द हाउसेस ऑफ पार्लियामेंट आफ्टर द प्रेसिडेंट्स एड्रेस टू द जॉइंट सेशन इन द सेंट्रल हॉल टुडे। द सर्वे प्रोजेक्ट्स इकोनॉमिक ग्रोथ एट 6 to 6.5% इन फिस्कल ईयर स्टार्टिंग 1st of April। So wealth creation is the central scheme of the Economic Survey 2020. Chief Economic Advisor K.V. Subramaniam said India has been a dominant economy for three quarters of recorded economic history. He said that such dominance happens by design due to an emphasis on wealth.
Wealth is both a cause and an effect of investment, especially private investment. Therefore, it is important for us to focus on wealth creation. For close to three quarters of recorded economic history, India has been the dominant economic power in the world. The economic survey posits that it is the combination of the invisible hand of the market supported by the hand of trust, which is what leads to wealth creation.
So Chief Economic Advisor also said that pro-business policies provide opportunities while pro-crony policies favor incumbents.
Transparency International's Corruption Perception Index, 2011 is when India actually was at its low. Before 2011, the connected companies actually earned much higher returns. But then there is a scissor-like movement after 2011 with the same connected companies earning lower returns since then. This is an important aspect because it relates to trust in the system and the difference between the pro-business policies that enable opportunity versus pro-crony policies that can favor incumbents.
So as the Finance Ministry presented economic survey today, our correspondent Arun Sharma spoke with Principal Economic Advisor Sanjeev Sanyal. Let's listen in.
First of all, sir, as far as this economic survey is concerned, what is the central theme of this economic survey?
The central theme of this economic survey is wealth creation. It builds on what we did last year, which was the theme of a $5 trillion economy, the idea of driving growth through boosting private investment. So we have revisited that theme. Particularly what we have done is made the case that if we want prosperity, if we want to pull people out of poverty, we need to focus on wealth creation, on entrepreneurship, on risk-taking, on startups.
But recently we have seen the economy being slowing down. So what does the economic survey talk about as far as boosting this economy is concerned, sir?
You're absolutely right. There has indeed been a moderation of growth in the last few quarters. But first of all, let me clarify. I mean, much of the media debate seems to suggest that we are in some sort of crisis. This is totally not the case. Growth remains high by any standards, and we are still among the fastest growing economies in the world, even with this moderation. Many of the other macro stability indicators are very well behaved. There has been a small spike in inflation, but the underlying core remains quite well contained. The external accounts are in very good condition. Whether you look at foreign exchange reserves, we are at record highs. The current account deficit has narrowed very sharply. In fact, both in percentage GDP terms, but even in dollar terms. You look at the banking sector, the gross NPA levels have stabilized and they should now begin to come down. So overall, there is no macro crisis as people tend to be. Look at all the macro indicators. They are at the best they've ever been. However, we do need to take into account the fact that the growth has slowed down. And here we have talked about many issues in the economic survey. Whether it is about monetary transmission, which is there in volume 2, and we extensively talk about it in the money and banking chapter. There is the whole issue, which is there in volume 1, mm-hmm. which is India's banking sector big enough? And we make the case that, in fact, it should be a order of magnitude larger than what it is. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, we talk extensively about ease of doing business. Mm-hmm. And there also, we have done a lot of interesting new research.
Okay. So, as you said, that the central theme is wealth creation, but the recent spike in inflation number, does that concern you when you're going in the path of wealth creation? Is that a concern for the government?
So, of course, whenever we look at prices moving, we do look at it with some concern. Let me point out that this has happened due to seasonal spike in food prices. These shocks do happen from time to time, and it's a good idea to supply some localized supply side measures may be needed. But I think the key here to note is that the underlying inflation, the core inflation rate, remains very, very well behaved. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that it will really influence inflationary expectations going forward, mm-hmm. or indeed have a major impact on the Reserve Bank's monetary thinking. So I think inflation remains very well behaved, even in the case of vegetables and other items. Certain measures are being taken, but even here, the survey does talk about the fact that the old style thinking, mm-hmm. Of demonizing the supply chains and storage as hoarding may be something we need to revisit. So we do talk about that in terms of how we need to modernize our the Essentials Commodity Act type of thinking and modernize it into a new type of thinking. So that is also there in the economic survey. But as far as inflation is concerned, I don't think it is a major issue at all.
Sir, as far as the last year's economic survey is concerned, we were talking about $5 trillion economy. This time we're talking about wealth creation. Banking sector is considered to be the backbone of the economy. So what major reforms are expected going forward? Or what is the focus area as far as the banking reforms are concerned in order to achieve the target of wealth creation, the target of $5 trillion economy?
So one of the things we have done in the economic survey is to point out that India's banking sector is curiously small compared to its economic size. So a country of our size should already have maybe 5 or 6 banks in the top global top 100, but we have just one. Even small country like Singapore has 3 in the global top 100. Mm-hmm. So our banking system is simply underdeveloped. Okay. Now, while we argue that we need to grow it by an order of magnitude, it is to be also noticed that in the past we could not have done it because we had a banking system which was poorly regulated or supervised. There were all kind of problems with creditor rights, with willful defaulters and so on, all of which you know. So we have spent the last several years cleaning up the banking system. Mm-hmm. You've seen the imposition of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, which has genuinely changed creditor rights. And I think there's been a genuine improvement in business culture in the country. So now I think the time has come where we can press the accelerator and begin to expand the banking system. The banking system is now ready for a very rapid expansion, and this is absolutely critical if we want to bring back private investment, create wealth, and you know, as I said, go back to growth rates where we are on track for that $5 trillion target.
All right, because when we talk about wealth creation, we also see the ease of doing business ranking as well. Recently, we have seen a massive improvement in ranking as far as ease of doing business is concerned. So what does the economic survey talks about as far as the improvement, as far as the ease of doing business rankings are concerned going forward as well?
So obviously, we have gone through a big improvement in our ease of doing business rankings, which the World Bank does every year. Going from, I think, 142 in 2014, and 5 years later, we are at 63. So that's clearly commendable. However, what we have done is to go and look at those categories where we have done particularly poorly and compared it to our peers, which are China, Indonesia, Brazil, and so on, and also compared it to the best in class, countries like Singapore, New Zealand, and so on. And so that we get a sense of how far behind we are on those parameters where we do badly, so that we can take a targeted approach to improve things.
So my last question to you would be that we're talking about $5 trillion economy by 2024. Just to conclude, what are the key components that we need to focus as of now in order to achieve that $5 trillion economy target, sir?
So there are obviously many of the things I just discussed. We do need to look at ease of doing business in a focused way. Spend time on mapping processes and regulatory environments. Only after you have gathered real-time information about what actually happens, not what should happen, but what actually happens, will we begin to be able to fix the process flows. So that's one. Secondly, we need to seriously think about our banking system being much, much larger than it is today.
So the budget session of the parliament started today with the President Ramnath Kovind's address to the joint session. President arrived with his entourage and was welcomed by the Prime Minister, Vice President and Lok Sabha Speaker. President Ramnath Kovind hailed the Citizenship Amendment Act as historic. He also said that the debate and discussion on any issue strengthens democracy while violence during protests weaken it. President Kovind also condemned atrocities against minority in Pakistan and urged the international community to take necessary action. Listen in to the 10 big takeaways of his address.
पारस्परिक चर्चा परिचर्चा तथा वाद विवाद लोकतंत्र को और सशक्त बनाते हैं वहीं विरोध के नाम पर किसी भी तरह की हिंसा समाज और देश को कमजोर करती है देश हित के लिए देश का हर नागरिक अपने कर्तव्य के प्रति जागरूक हो कर्तव्य के प्रति समर्पित हो आइए हम सब 2020 के दशक को कर्तव्यों का दशक बनाए भारत ने हमेशा सर्वपंथ समभाव पर विश्वास किया है लेकिन विभाजन के समय सबसे ज्यादा प्रहार भारत और भारतवासियों के इसी विश्वास पर किया गया है विभाजन के बाद बने माहौल में राष्ट्रपिता महात्मा गांधी ने कहा था कि पाकिस्तान के हिंदू और सिख जो वहां नहीं रहना चाहते वे भारत आ सकते हैं उन्हें सामान्य जीवन मुहैया कराना भारत सरकार का कर्तव्य है मुझे प्रसन्नता है कि संसद के दोनों सदनों द्वारा नागरिकता संशोधन कानून बनाकर उनकी इच्छा को पूरा किया गया पाकिस्तान में अल्पसंख्यकों पर हो रहे अत्याचार की निंदा करते हुए विश्व समुदाय से इसका संज्ञान लेने और इस दिशा में आवश्यक कदम उठाने का भी आग्रह करता हूँ मेरी सरकार का ये पुनः स्पष्ट करती है कि भारत में आस्था रखने वाले और भारत की नागरिकता लेने के इच्छुक दुनिया के सभी पंथों के व्यक्तियों के लिए जो प्रक्रियाएं पहले थी वे आज भी वैसी ही हैं किसी भी पंथ का व्यक्ति इन प्रक्रियाओं को पूरा करके भारत का नागरिक बन सकता है जम्मू कश्मीर एवं लद्दाख के लोगों को वहां के दलितों और महिलाओं को भी वही अधिकार मिले हैं जो बाकी देशवासियों को प्राप्त हैं संसद के दोनों सदनों द्वारा दो तिहाई बहुमत से संविधान के अनुच्छेद 370 और अनुच्छेद 35A को हटाया जाना न सिर्फ ऐतिहासिक है बल्कि इससे जम्मू कश्मीर और लद्दाख के समान विकास का भी मार्ग प्रशस्त हुआ है 5 दशकों से चली आ रही बोडो समस्या को समाप्त करने के लिए केंद्र और असम सरकार ने हाल ही में बोडो संगठनों के साथ ऐतिहासिक समझौता किया है इस समझौते से ऐसी जटिल समस्या जिसमें 4000 से ज्यादा लोगों की मृत्यु हुई उसका समाधान निकला है। समझौते के बाद बोडो समुदाय के विकास के लिए सरकार द्वारा 1500 करोड़ रुपए खर्च किए जाएंगे। हमारा संविधान लोकतांत्रिक प्रक्रियाओं से हुए निर्णयों को देशवासियों द्वारा स्वीकार किए जाने की अपेक्षा भी रखता है। इसके साथ ही हमारा संविधान इस संसद से तथा इस सदन में उपस्थित प्रत्येक सदस्य से राष्ट्रहित को सर्वोपरि रखते हुए देशवासियों की आशाओं आकांक्षाओं की पूर्ति करने और उनके लिए आवश्यक कानून बनाने की अपेक्षा भी रखता है। दुनिया भर में आने वाली चुनौतियों के बावजूद भारत की अर्थव्यवस्था की नींव मजबूत है। हमारा विदेशी मुद्रा भंडार 450 बिलियन डॉलर से भी ऊपर के ऐतिहासिक स्तर पर है। निस्वार्थ भाव से देश की सेवा करने वाले किसानों की जिंदगी बदले, ग्रामीण क्षेत्रों का विकास हो, ये मेरी सरकार की प्राथमिकता है। ग्रामीण अर्थव्यवस्था को मजबूत बनाने के लिए आने वाले वर्षों में सरकार 25 लाख करोड़ रुपए की राशि खर्च करने जा रही है।
Now let us see the reactions of Union Ministers on President Ramnath Kovind's address.
उनका भाषण अभिभाषण बहुत ही सारगर्भित था और जो कुछ भी एक राष्ट्रपति महोदय के द्वारा ऐसे अवसर पर कहा जाना चाहिए वो सब सारी बातें उन्होंने कही हैं।
जो आज राष्ट्रपति जी का अभिभाषण है वो समावेशी समृद्ध और सशक्त भारत के संकल्प को प्रदर्शित करता है और समावेशी समृद्ध और सशक्त भारत के संकल्प से भरपूर है। साथ ही राष्ट्रपति जी के अभिभाषण में बहुत स्पष्ट है कि ये किसी की नागरिकता को लेने के लिए नहीं है बल्कि तीन देशों के पीड़ित प्रताड़ित लोगों को नागरिकता देने से संबंधित है।
माननीय राष्ट्रपति जी का भाषण समग्रता को अपने आप में समग्र रूप से संजोए हुए था। उन्होंने सरकार की उपलब्धियों का जिक्र किया और जो जिक्र किया उन सारे जिक्रों में गत वर्षों में भारत की जो बुनियाद मजबूत हुई है और नए भारत के निर्माण की जो नींव रखी गई है उन सब का समावेश उनके भाषण में था। मैं समझता हूँ यह भाषण उत्साहित करने वाला था, देश को प्रोत्साहित करने वाला था, देश में कर्तव्यों का जागरण करने वाला था और कर्तव्य के प्रति लोग प्रतिबद्ध हों इसके लिए राष्ट्रपति जी ने अपने भाषण में सभी नागरिकों को प्रोत्साहित किया है।
सरकार का जितना भी उपलब्धि को राष्ट्रपति जी ने जो उद्बोधन में सामने रखा वो देश का जनता उसको देख करके संतुष्ट का भाव होगा कि पहली बार कोई सरकार आया है पिछले 5 सालों में और फिर अभी जो शुरुआत की है अगले टर्म के लिए इतना काम किसी सरकार ने आज तक नहीं किया।
Vice President Venkaiah Naidu addressed the joint session of the parliament. He said that after the abrogation of Article 370, rapid development can be seen in Jammu and Kashmir.
Rapid development of Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh, preservation of their culture and traditions, transparent and honest administration and democratic empowerment are among the priorities of my government. During the president rule and since becoming a union territory, all the development projects in Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh have gained momentum. Towards the end of year 2018, elections more than 4,400 panchayats of Jammu Kashmir were conducted in a peaceful manner. For the first time since independence, elections to more than 300 block development councils have also been held there.
So Vice President also praised ISRO in his speech and said that with Chandrayaan and Gaganyaan projects, Indian space is adding new feathers to its cap.
The objective of India's space program has always been service to humanity. Due to tireless work of country's space scientists, Chandrayaan 2 has stimulated a new interest in technology among country's youth. My government have already approved Chandrayaan 3. ISRO is also working expeditiously on the manned spacecraft program Gaganyaan as well as Aditya 1 mission.
The BJP today released Delhi Sankalp Patra, its manifesto for Delhi Assembly polls, and asserted that the party will change the city's future. The document was released in presence of Union Ministers Nitin Gadkari, Prakash Javrekar, Harshvardhan, party's Delhi Union President Manoj Tiwari, and MPs. The manifesto promises to make Delhi tanker-free and provide tapped drinking water to every household by 2024 and provide employment to 10 lakh people in the next 5 years. It also talked about establishing a new skill development university in the city. Addressing the media, Gadkari said BJP's history is linked to Delhi. The future of Delhi will be changed by the Bharatiya Janata Party.
आज मुझे इस बात की खुशी है कि दिल्ली की तकदीर को, दिल्ली के भविष्य को हम बदलने वाले हैं, ये तो भविष्य की बात होगी। पर आज तक जब जब भी भारतीय जनता पार्टी के नेताओं को अवसर मिला है, जब अटल बिहारी वाजपेयी जी की सरकार थी तब भी हो या आज मोदी जी की सरकार है, हमने हर बार दिल्ली के तकदीर और दिल्ली के भविष्य को बदलने का काम किया है। जो संकल्प पत्र है वो आज रिलीज हुआ है। मैं मनोज तिवारी जी को और विशेष रूप से हमारे सभी कार्यकर्ताओं को, उम्मीदवारों को, हमारे सभी सांसदों को, हमारे नेता डॉक्टर हर्षवर्धन जी दिल्ली के भी सांसद हैं, प्रकाश जी भी हैं, इनको सबको एक बहुत अच्छा संकल्प पत्र उनने तैयार किया।
Moving on, Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal today participated in road shows in Rajouri Garden and Mangolpuri area of Delhi. The national capital will go to polls in a single phase on February 8th and the counting of the votes will take place on February 11th. Air India special flight departed today from Delhi for China's Wuhan for evacuation of Indians. Air India CMD Ashwini Lohani said that at least 400 Indians will be evacuated today from Wuhan in China by Air India flight. He added that flights will return by 2 a.m. tomorrow. He further recalled how Air India had come forward when nation needs it in the earlier events. The crew is traveling with masks, gloves and disinfectant sprays and will not get off the aircraft in the Wuhan city. There will be minimal contact with the passengers during the flight, and this is the first flight operation for evacuation. A special flight likely to depart from Delhi airport tomorrow.
Air India ke special flight Wuhan sahar mein ja raha hai, jahan par coronavirus ke maamle saamne aaye hain. हम जानना चाहते हैं, सीएमडी हमारे साथ हैं डॉक्टर अश्विनी लोहानी, उनसे कि किस तरह के ऑपरेशन है।
देखिए, ये इंडियंस को इवैक्यूएट करने का ऑपरेशन है और ये पहले भी इस तरह के इवैक्यूएशन के मिशंस एयर इंडिया करता रहा है और क्यों ना करें, क्योंकि एयर इंडिया एक राष्ट्रीय ध्वजवाहक है, नेशनल कैरियर है और इसकी रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटीज़ भी होती हैं। तो इवैक्यूएशन का मिशन है जिसमें हमारे स्टाफ जा रहे हैं और एक बार भी हमारे किसी स्टाफ ने ये नहीं बोला कि उनको कोई दिक्कत है जाने में या डर लगता है जाने में। बिल्कुल अच्छे ढंग से आगे बढ़ के एयर इंडिया इस मिशन को कर रहा है। विद अ लॉट ऑफ प्राइड वी हैव टू सर्व द नेशन।
क्या खास उनके प्रोटेक्शन की व्यवस्था की है, क्योंकि बहुत ही वायरस तेज़ी से स्प्रेड करता है, उनके लिए प्रोटेक्शन की क्या व्यवस्था की?
मास्क हैं, प्रोटेक्शन गियर है, जो भी ले जाया जा रहा है तो आई थिंक वो एडिक्वेट होना चाहिए।
और किस तरह के पैसेंजर को पहले स्लॉट में लाया जाए?
वो तो वहीं पे एमईए के जो लोग हैं उन्होंने प्रबंध किया है, तो वहीं की प्लानिंग है, उसके बारे में यहाँ कुछ भी बताना पॉसिबल नहीं है।
कितनी क्षमता होगी लाने की, कितने एक बार?
हमारे जहाज़ की कैपेसिटी करीब 400 के करीब की कैपेसिटी है, तो उतने लोग आ पाएंगे इसमें।
तो ये थे अश्विनी लोहानी, सीएमडी एयर इंडिया, जिन्होंने कहा कि पूरी तरीके से प्रोटेक्शन की व्यवस्था है जब यहाँ से क्रू जाएगा। और उसके अलावा ये एक एयर इंडिया जो नेशनल करियर है उसके लिए भी एक प्राइड का विषय है, क्योंकि जब भी संकट आता है दुनिया में, हमारे जब नागरिक कहीं फंसे होते हैं उनको लाने में हमेशा मददगार रहा एयर इंडिया। कैमरामैन कुमार दत्ता के साथ नितेंद्र सिंह, डीडी न्यूज़, दिल्ली।
So Indian Army has created a quarantine facility near Manesar where approximately 300 Indian students arriving from Wuhan, China can be monitored for a duration of 2 weeks by a qualified team of doctors and staff members to watch for any signs of infection. The procedure of screening and quarantine will comprise of two steps. The first one being screening at airport followed by quarantine at Manesar, and if any individual is suspected to be infected, he or she will be shifted to the isolation ward at the base hospital, Delhi Cantonment. The facility consists of accommodation, barracks for the students, administrative areas and medical facility area. The World Health Organization on Thursday has declared the novel coronavirus outbreak as public health emergency of international concern. However, the UN health body stressed that it does not recommend limiting trade and travel. Meanwhile, death toll in China from coronavirus has reached 213. WHO director said that the WHO's biggest concern was the potential for the virus to spread to countries with less developed health systems. Moving on, three terrorists have been killed and one policeman injured in a gunfight at a toll plaza in Nagrota on the outskirts of Jammu. Jammu and Kashmir DGP said that the firing took place around 5 a.m. early morning when the police team stopped a Srinagar-bound truck for checking near toll plaza in the Bun area of Nagrota. The group of 3-4 terrorists were on their way to Srinagar. The DGP also informed that three terrorists are killed in the ensuing gunfight. A massive search operation also launched to track down the terrorist. Senior police officials are at the spot to oversee the combing operations, while traffic has been suspended temporarily on the highway. Authorities have also ordered the closure of all schools today in Nagrota as a precautionary measure. So Jammu IG Mukesh Singh said that three terrorists have been killed in the encounter while one police personnel is injured. He said that the area has been cordoned and search operation is still on. Moving on, cricket news now. In another thrilling game, India defeated New Zealand after the match went into super over. India restricted Kiwis at the scores of 165, which tied the match. Host Kiwis got off to a comfortable start in the fourth T20 game in Wellington, but later Indian bowlers were fabulous in their show. Batting first in the super over, New Zealand gave the target of 14 runs to India. Indian batsmen proved their worth again to win the match easily. Earlier, India handed host New Zealand 166 to chase in Wellington. Manish Pandey played the anchor's role to score a fluent half century, while opener KL Rahul chipped in with 39 runs. Manish's half century was his third in T20 cricket for India. India's top order failed to get going, with Sanju Samson, Virat Kohli and Shreyas Iyer all falling cheaply to put the visitors on the back foot. Hamish Bennett was the pick of the bowlers, picking up 2 wickets for the host. Rohit Sharma and Kane Williamson were out of this game, with Tim Southee being handed the captain's armband to lead the hosts. News from the world of tennis now. The second semi-final of Australian Open between Dominic Thiem and Alexander Zverev is underway. Dominic Thiem and Alexander Zverev are logging horns on a Grand Slam court for the third time in their careers. Previously, they've met twice at Roland Garros. At Australian Open 2020, it is their first major meeting on a hard surface. Also, their first major semi-final encounter. World number 5 Thiem has an upper hand in their head-to-head record. He has just lost twice to Zverev out of the 8 times they have met previously. Speaking about their most recent meeting at the ATP Finals 2019, Thiem dethroned the defending champion Sasha in straight sets in the semi-finals. Also, the Austrian is playing his 4th Grand Slam semi-final, while for the German, it's an unexplored zone. However, Zverev won't be an easy test to clear. The winner will fight with Novak Djokovic for the Grand Slam title on Sunday. Well, that's all we have on this news bulletin. Stay tuned for more news and updates. Namaskar.